Perfect, yeah. All right, Giulio, time is yours.
Thanks. Okay, hi everybody, I'm Giulio Passerotti, I'm a PhD student in Ocean Engineering at the University of Melbourne. This presentation will be focused on the work of my first year of PhD regarding a physical model of sea ice breakup induced by surface waves. So in the context of the polar environment, the strongest interaction between sea ice and waves occur at the marginalized zone, that is the region covered by broken flows between the open ocean and the continuous ice cover. So waves penetrate and propagate deep into the ice covered ocean and break up the level ice into flows. At the same time, the ice field impacts the waves, causing the progressive wave energy dissipation, in turn attenuating the wave-driven effects. In addition, waves introduce warm water and overwash the flows, accelerating ice melt and causing ice collision. Due to this mutual interaction in the atmospheric events, the marginalized zone is a region extremely dynamic that is expected to expand in the future as the result of the ongoing sea ice retreat. So increasing our knowledge about wave-ice interaction and sea ice properties is fundamental to integrate this information in sea ice models and in larger scale in climate system models. And the research community has made several efforts in this direction. However, the validation of the available models is limited by the lack of datasets of sea ice properties, and in particular, local measurements of wave and ice during the breakup events. So the observations of the ice breakup in a laboratory environment under controlled conditions can improve our understanding and support field observations and theory. In the experiment described in our paper, we studied the transition from a continuous to a broken ice cover, applying image analysis to extract the flow's properties, and pressure sensors to analyze the evolution of the wave spectrum and attenuation of the spectral frequency. The experiment was performed at the Alto Ice Tank facility in Finland that allowed the generation of waves propagating to an ice sheet thanks to the computer controlled wave maker at one end, while at the opposite end there is a linear beach to absorb the incoming wave energy. The experiment consists in a series of tests with increasingly energetic incident waves that ranges from causing no breakup to breaking up the entire ice cover. An ice cover of 3 centimeters was produced over the entire surface, and the ice mechanical properties were measured with destructive cantilever beam tests. Then a 3-meter strip was removed to allow the wave generation in open water. The properties of model ice in field scale were found to be consistent with realistic sea ice, except for the Young's modules that was about 2 orders of magnitude smaller. The wave maker was set based on the Pearson-Moscovy spectrum to generate unidirectional random waves that follows a Rayleigh distribution. And the wavelength and the peak wave period were constant, while the test differ for the chosen wave height value, defining different level of wave steepness. Benchmark tests without the ice sheet are conducted to verify the incident wave fields. 3 wave gauges were placed in the open water strip, and 5 pressure sensors below the ice cover to track the water surface elevation along the tank. A camera was installed at the end of the tank, 5 meters above the ice cover, and inclined of 45 degrees to record videos of the ice surface. And 60 markers were positioned on the ice sheet to provide reference and allow the reconstruction of dimensions during the video analysis. So in the area comprised between the ice breaking front and the ice water edge, the breakup occurs both longitudinally and transversally, generating ice flows of non-trivial shape. So I designed an automated algorithm to extract the ice breaking front, the ice water edge, and the individual ice flows geometries from 1 video frame per second. Basically, the raw frames were rectified onto the horizontal plane to extrapolate dimensions of pixels. Then I used the Sober filter to capture color gradients, emphasize edges, in order to identify iceberg in front and ice water edge, and estimate their distance from the wave maker. For the flows detection, the images were banalized with a user selected threshold, and the boundaries of the flows were determined using the canny edge detector. Finally, the flow shape was approximated as an ellipse to easily retrieve the longitudinal and the transverse dimension, D1 and D2. Okay, these first graphs represent the temporal evolution of the iceberg in front and the ice water edge for each steepness. With the blue area denoting the open water, the gray area the ice sheet, and the light blue area the region of broken flows. Waves with a low steepness propagate through the continuous ice cover without generating any fracture. However, the overwash of the ice edge accelerated the ice edge melt and crumbling for about a meter. That corresponds to the initial difference between ice water edge and breaking front for the intermediate steepness. At this steepness, the ice starts to break up, and after six minutes, the breaking front and the ice edge begin to advance at about the same speed, keeping the area of broken flows constant. Finally, with the highest steepness, that is a common condition in the Southern Ocean, the total breakup of the ice cover is reached, and these results are consistent with what observed in other similar experiments. After the image processing, it's also possible to evaluate the flow size distribution, here expressed on the left by the scatter diagrams and by the probability density functions on the right, for both the intermediate and large steepness. The data include all flows detected from all images taken. For both the steepnesses, the linear fits, the red lines on the scatter diagrams, shows that on average D2 is about 3 times D1, confirming the elongated flow shapes. Then the weighable distributions, the dashed lines, are fitted to the empirical PDFs. And when the beta shape parameter is equal to 2, the weighable distribution degenerates to a Rayleigh distribution, which is linked with the wave statistics. So we can see that PDF of flow size in the wave direction tends to the same statistical distribution of the incident wave field as the steepness increases. For what concerns wave behavior, this figure displays a portion of the time series of the water pressure oscillations, with the bottom series representing the incoming wave field. In general, attenuations gradually assume relevance as the waves propagate into the ice, with the ice acting as a low-pass filter by cutting off high-frequency components. The filtering causes the emergence of wave group structures in agreement with the recent field observation in the Arctic. All these effects become less significant as the wave steepness increases and the ice starts to break up. The time series at each probe were then used to compute the wave energy spectrum with a Fourier transform approach. Here, a representation of the evolution of the full wave spectrum in ice, with the light blue area denoting the incident open water spectrum. This figure confirms that energy attenuation is more intense at the high frequencies, regardless of the steepness. The energy dissipated increases as waves propagate in ice and is more conspicuous at the lowest steepness due to the compact ice cover. The result is a significant spectral downshift within only a few wavelengths of propagation. These graphs show zero-order moment, mean wave period and frequency bandwidth extracted from the wave energy spectrum. Each quantity is normalized by the incident counterpart, and the frequency bandwidth is calculated at 1/10 of the spectral energy content. As expected, energy attenuates with distance from the ice edge, with the ice condition affecting the entity of energy dissipated. So in the upper panel, waves dissipate about 50% of the initial energy after 5 meters if the ice is compact, 50% if it is partially broken, and less than 5% if it is fully broken. And this last result is not surprising, considering that the ice edge retreats beyond the first sensor after only 5 minutes of test. As a consequence of wave attenuation, the mean period increases and the spectral width decreases compared to the incident value. for all three tests at the far test location, the mean period are about 1.25 larger than the incident value, and the spectral bandwidth 0.70 smaller. This figure shows the attenuation as a function of the frequency normalized by the peak frequency of the incident wave field. An overall attenuation rate is computed with an ordinary least square estimator using all records from the five pressure sensors. The shaded area represents the 95% confidence intervals, and the yellow, red, and green dashed lines represent the reference slopes f to the power of n with n equal to 2, 3, and 4. This is because field data suggested wave attenuation scales with frequency following this relation. It's important to mention that waves behave linearly, and so each estimate can be considered as the attenuation of a monochromatic wave. For all the steepness tests in the range 0.8 1.4 FPE, where the energy content of the wave spectra is higher, the experiment agrees with the scaling exponents indicated by the literature, with an empirical attenuation slightly closer to n equal to 4 than 3 or 2. This figure shows the joint distribution of individual wave heights and related periods recorded at a location where the ice remain compact and where the ice transitioned to broken. With the blue and red lines represent the average and maximum steepness for each dataset. For unbroken ice, the data are distributed along an average steepness of 0.01, that is half of the characteristic steepness of the mildest incident wave field tested, meaning that the joint distribution is flatter than its open water counterpart. Therefore, the wave-induced load on the ice cover is too weak to cause the breakup. In contrast, when the ice transition to broken, the shape of the distribution is more similar to the joint distribution in open water. More than 10% of waves exceed the maximum steepness for the unbroken ice, confirming a significant load on the ice cover. Here, I calculated the wave-induced breakup parameter proposed by Wormans that merged both wave and ice properties. So the graph shows I for each test and location, normalized by 0.014, that is the universal breaking threshold founded by Wormans. And the filled marker symbols indicate that the ice is broken. So for the lowest steepness test, the ice is unbroken at all locations, while for the intermediate steepness, the wave field breaks the ice at the first two locations, but the breaking parameter is always below the universal threshold. For the largest steepness breaks the ice cover at all locations, with a breaking parameter spanning a range of values below and above the proposed threshold. It's important to mention that for some tests and locations shown as broken ice, the ice cover is actually unbroken for part of the test, but the measurements during a broken phase are still included, possibly adding some uncertainty to the breaking parameter value. Okay. In conclusion, a brief recap of the main results of the experiment. So the breakup occurred both in the longitudinal and transverse directions, and the flows are shown to be well approximated by ellipses. The flow size distribution in the wave propagation tends to the Rayleigh distribution, similar to the distribution of the incident waves. The edge of the continuous ice cover was found to have a major impact on the wave properties, which was reduced or removed when the ice at the edge was broken. And the exponential wave energy attenuation rate shows a power load dependence on frequency similar to that found from field measurements. Thanks for the attention.
Thank you very much, Giulio. Very interesting experiments indeed. I guess also very challenging. I'll first start and see if there's any, are there any questions from the audience, from the attendees? Yeah, I see there's one. Oh, it's gone now. Yeah, Fabien, please. Hi, yeah, thank you, Giulio. That was a very, very good talk.